Hello again, my name is Nick, and thanks for joining me in this series, Jesus and the Gospels. In our previous lesson, we introduced some of the significant historical events that helped shape the Mediterranean landscape, which would pave the way for the spread of the gospel and the most important time in human history, the arrival of Jesus of Nazareth. We began part one with the destruction of the first temple under King Nebuchadnezzar in 586 BC, and the later rebuilding of the second temple in Jerusalem after the Persian king Cyrus set forth a decree allowing the Hebrew people back into the land. Several centuries later, two bitter rivals, Greece and Persia, who were struggling for world domination and the annihilation of one another, Alexander the Great arose to power and fulfilled his father's dream of destroying the Persians. Shortly after Alexander conquered much of what we know as Eastern Europe, the Middle East, and extending to the far reaches of the borders of India, Alexander mysteriously died in 323 BC, and his kingdom was divided among his four leading generals, and that's where we begin today. Here's a map of Alexander's kingdom after his death. It didn't take long after these four generals gained power for them to begin fighting amongst each other. Eventually, two dominant rulers emerged and established the power. The dynasty of the Ptolemies, who were centered in Egypt, and the dynasty of the Seleucids, who reigned in the north, in Syria. And which country was sandwiched right in the center of these two dynasties? You guessed it, Israel. So Israel became a nation of tug-of-war between these two dominant powers. And while the Ptolemies in Egypt had power, Israel lived in peace for around 125 years. The shift in power. Until 198 BC, the Syrians had failed to gain control of Israel, but when a Seleucid ruler by the name of Antiochus III took rule, he defeated Egypt and took control of Israel. Now, some of Antiochus's aspiration to take control of other lands was actually dampened by a new rising power in the West. Who do you think that was? The Romans, who laid a heavy taxation on Antiochus. Now enter Antiochus's son, Antiochus Epiphanes, a self-designated name he gave himself, which means a manifestation of God. And Antiochus Epiphanes was a very committed Hellenist who insisted that those stubborn jewels fully conform to Greek culture, and if they didn't, there would be harsh consequences. It was during this time a number of terrible things happened. Antiochus cut down thousands of innocent men, women, and children on the Sabbath who didn't fight because it was the Lord's day. He sold the office of the high priest to the highest bidder, first to Jason, and later to Melanus, who had no priestly ancestry. So he was actually forbidden from even holding that position. Antiochus forced the Jewish males to stop performing the practice of circumcision. Sabbath observance was outlawed, and Jews had to offer sacrifices to Antiochus. Now you can only imagine what that led to. And if they refused to offer sacrifices to the Greek gods in Antiochus, Josephus tells us he performed the most exquisite tortures on the Jews. Sometime later, Antiochus performed what is known as the Abomination of Desolation. After being humiliated by a Roman general, he took his frustrations out on the temple. First, he looted it of all of its treasure. He then proceeded to sacrifice a pig on the Holy of Holies. He also ordered that all scriptures be burned. It was a terrible, terrible time in Israel's history, but a rebellion was brewing. From the years 166 to 135 BC, some pious Jews realized that Antiochus's actions were actually threatening the very existence of Jews. In one story, some Syrian forces arrived in the town of Modin to force people into worshiping false gods, and a godly man named Mattathias, his five sons, and several others stood up to them. So in this video clip, we're going to watch the initial events as recorded by Josephus and Maccabees, which led to the overthrow of the Syrian juggernaut Antiochus and his armies. And as I previously stated, this is all told in the Old Testament in 1 and 2 Maccabees. Now, this is important for a variety of reasons, but the point that I really want to draw out of this is the rise of the Hasmonean dynasty.
That took place over 2,000 years ago. Around 200 BC, the Jewish people in Jerusalem were living under Egyptian rule, though they remained largely free to work and worship in accordance with their customs. Then, in 175 BC, Antiochus IV Epiphanes ascended to the Syrian throne, invaded Egypt, and desecrated Jerusalem. In an attempt to assimilate the Judean people, Antiochus forced them to worship Greek gods and outlawed Judaism, banning all Jewish rituals upon threat of death. The ultimate insult came in 168 BC, when Antiochus seized the Jewish Holy Temple in Jerusalem and dedicated it to the worship of Greek god Zeus. For a Jewish high priest named Mattathias, it was time to take a stand. Together with his five sons, Mattathias sparked a revolt, pitting the desperate Jewish faithful against vastly superior Syrian armies. The battle raged for 3 years. Against improbable odds, the Jewish uprising, led by Mattathias' son, Judah Maccabee, emerged victorious. Judah Maccabee and his small army of soldiers recaptured Jerusalem in 165 BC and liberated the Holy Temple. According to the Talmud, the Jewish high priests eagerly prepared to light the ceremonial menorah, the eternal flame which would rededicate the desecrated temple to the glory of God. But they found that the Syrians had defiled all but a small flask of oil. It was enough to light the menorah, but for a single night. Hours turned to days, and miraculously, the menorah burned on until 8 nights had passed and more oil could be produced. It was time for Hanukkah, Hebrew for dedication. Against all odds, the menorah had not been extinguished, and so the flames of the branched menorah are a potent symbol of the Jews' indomitable faith.
The significance of the Maccabean Revolt. While Simon reigned as a leader and priest, power struggles ensued. Simon and his two sons were killed in the year 135 BC. His only surviving son, John Hyrcanus, sought to unify Israel. And some of the things he did was whip up on the Edomites, who were descendants of Esau, forcing Judaism onto them. He also conquered the Samaritans, burning down their temple on Mount Gerizim. And he really stoked the fire that had already been smoldering for some time after the destruction of the first temple. And you can see all sorts of evidence in the Gospels of this antagonism, specifically in Luke 9 and 10. But later on, these Hasmoneans adopted Greek Hellenism, which caused some of the pious committed Jews to break off. And this is where we see the rise of the Pharisees and the Essenes. Both the Pharisees and the Essenes thought that there should be separation between king and priest, and that the high priest should be from the tribe of Levi. And the third party to emerge during this time were the Sadducees, who sided with Greek Hellenism. The rise of religious sects in Israel, 160 to 63 BC. In the year 160 BC, Judas Maccabeus dies in battle. Leadership is then passed down first to Jonathan, his brother, second Simon, who gained the title leader and priest, and then the line of priests are known as the Hasmonean dynasty. As we already touched on, John Hyrcanus seeks to unify Israel by force, but there is also a rise of religious and political parties, Pharisees, Essenes, and Sadducees. Until 63 BC, the Jews pretty much ruled by their own power, but with the rise of Rome, General Pompey captured Jerusalem, which was really in a weakened state because of the power struggles that were going on. So now, Pompey, or Rome, was calling the shots, and they appointed the leadership, and that went to Hyrcanus II. But the real power behind the throne was a man named Antipater, an Idumean who gained lots of favor from the Romans. The Romans eventually appointed Antipater as governor of Judea, and he appointed one of his sons, Herod, as a military commander of Jerusalem and Galilee. Herod the Great, king of the Jews and ruler of Israel from 37 to 4 BC. Herod ruled as king of the Jews, a familiar moniker that you've perhaps heard before in the Gospels at the time of Jesus' crucifixion, as was written on the titulus, King of the Jews. As I said, Herod ruled from 37 to 4 BC. Now, there are several Herods that appear in the Gospels, and they are all descendants of Herod the Great. What's interesting about Herod is he built the most significant structures that still stand today. Caesarea, Herodium, renovation of the Second Temple, aqueducts, Masada, the list goes on and on. As far as where Herod descended, Herod was a strange mix of a clever and efficient ruler, but he was also a cruel tyrant. On the one hand, he was distrustful, jealous, and brutal, and he had a knack for destroying or crushing opposition or anyone that opposed him. Now, the Jews never really accepted Herod because he was an Idumean, so he was never considered a real king in the sight of the Jews, and this rejection really infuriated him. In an attempt to become legitimate, he divorced his wife Doris and married a Hasmonean princess, Miriamne, but he later killed her on suspicion of plotting against him. Oh, speaking of murder, he also had his mother and grandfather killed, his brother-in-law, and three of his own sons. In fact, he also drowned the high priest at a swimming party near Jericho. Even in the days leading up to his death, Herod, who was now despised by the entire populace, feared that no one would mourn his death. So he ordered that all Jewish priests be arrested, hauled into the hippodrome, and when Herod drew his last breath, they were to be massacred by archers, thus calling many to mourn the day of his death. Fortunately, when Herod died, his sister Salome released the priest. Augustus once famously said, "He would rather be Herod's pig than his son."